My name is Andrew Johnston. I'm the president of Energy Thoughts Summit. It really feels unnecessary to have a microphone right now. This is the quietest I've had to talk all week, so that's great. So we'll keep it at that rate. This is probably one of the most fun topics that we have here, and it's probably one of the most potentially far-reaching. It's essentially around how future use cases are driving a lot of the new advances in technology. But sometimes, you know, one of the things that's really interesting, especially in our prep calls that I enjoyed, was hearing about death by use case, like, you know, finding narrow use cases that just hurt whatever advances and applications can be built off that original. So how do you create these fully fleshed out use cases, not just in one type of part of the energy spectrum, but in that whole life cycle of the energy space? And so, I mean, we're lucky enough, we have Garrett. So I'll let everyone introduce themselves, and I'd ask you guys to just say your name, your title, and how you work with use cases and trends in tech in this space. And so some of you are from utilities, other from R&D shops, other from technology providers, retail energy. So sort of say where you fit in, because this is a far-ranging panel, and you do all have sort of your own constellation, or star in the constellation, as it were. So sure. Please, feel free.
Okay, hi. My name is Garrett Hester. Thanks for having me, Drew. I've really enjoyed the conference so far.
Thanks.
I've been working at Direct Energy and Centrica, which is our parent company, for about 8 years, 7 or 8 years now. So a lot of energy expertise, and along with technology and operations. So what we've done over the past few years is I've been leading the delivery arm of our innovation group,
and innovation in what space?
Right. So innovation in the residential energy space, and you know, that looks a lot like partnerships and bundling of products together in today's world. I think. It'll evolve more as we talk more about what the trends that we see evolving in the market. But really, our focus has been on looking at the connected home space, and then understanding that we're not going to be everything to everyone, but understanding that we do have a deep expertise and an advantage to bring our energy expertise directly to consumers and help them make decisions that help them use less energy, conserve, and also just delight them and bring more value to their lives.
And you used to be in the innovation implementation side, which, I mean, let's be honest, new ideas need friends. When you come into a space saying a new thing, implementing that internally as well as externally, that's a different bailiwick altogether.
Yeah, we have the privilege and the curse of innovating within a large organization. So I don't know, there are probably practitioners in the audience as well. And I know, Liz is an example of that too. When you're trying to bring change, and the IoT space, the technology space, is developing and iterating on itself so quickly, when you're trying to bring that into a large organization, it takes a lot of work. There's a lot of barriers to overcome, but there's also a lot of advantages to having a national truck fleet that can roll trucks in every state in the United States. There's an advantage to having a reputation with your consumers about understanding energy and a trusted brand. And so we're trying to meld those things together to bring more value to our customers. And it's been pretty exciting.
Nice, awesome. All right, Liz, so I can see everyone.
Good afternoon, and thanks for having me.
Absolutely.
I'm Liz Jambor. I work at Austin Energy, our city's electric company. I manage a group called Data Analytics and Business Intelligence. And we get to touch all of the groups within Austin Energy and several of the city departments, depending on whether we're doing product development, market research, contracts compliance, or measurement and verification.
You're separate from IT, too.
We're
Sorry,
separate
we need
from
to make
IT.
That distinction.
That's right.
Yeah.
So we have this very unique name because we were several disparate groups that got put under one umbrella, and that was the one name that kind of covered us all. So, we're the rogue nation, our IT group thinks, that's right. I believe in forgiveness rather than permission. And most of the IT or AE people here are not my leadership, so that's good. She is at the paramount right now. So, I guess one of the unique things about being a municipal utility is that sometimes our cogs move very, very slowly. You know, you talk about being a large organization. We are a really large organization that sometimes is planted in the 1980s. Mm. And so we're trying to move very quickly in the 21st century with a product that people only think about when it's not working. So people rarely think about their electricity except when it's out. And then they're really thinking about it and they're not happy about it. So how do we engage with our customers that have the gamut of technology skill sets, and how do we engage them in a way to teach them how to use this thing? And then in my group, because I'm part of Customer Energy Solutions, which is the rebate and renewables, how do we teach them to use less of the one commodity we're trying to sell? Which makes absolutely no sense on the surface.
Especially with a volumetric business model. So congrats on cannibalizing your business model. That's
Yeah. I mean, to have those conversations with people in the
sort of like a wedding diet. Yeah. Like you just want to eventually vanish, right? You know.
But it makes sense when you tell the whole story. But you know, to have that relationship with customers that we're trying to help them. That's what it comes down to.
Yes.
We're trying to help them. And it's through technology that we figure out the unique ways that we can help them, because they're also very different.
So these two represent the space where there is these large organizations where this new change needs to happen relatively quickly, but on pace with other capital improvement projects, new larger scale projects like, you know, getting your SCADA right, getting your MDM in your case, and in your case, getting this connected to the interoperability of that connected home. So this is a real world consideration side of the panel, these two people. These guys are the whiz bang, fun stuff, who knows what happens next, we do, part of the panel. So interoperability, I mean, it's the theme of the day. So no, but I mean, everything from VR to wearables, computer learning, distributed logic, you guys have a real space in it, Jared. Sorry, do you mind just pulling up sort of saying the basics about Chaiwan, but also some of this really exciting like trend stuff that you guys get to play around in, the whiz bang stuff.
Most of the stuff we do is fun and whiz bang.
Shiny objects.
But yeah, I mean, well, so
make
my name.
All jealous.
Yeah.
My name. I have a great job. I really do. So my name is Jared Huke. I'm director of VP of Design and User Experience at Chaiwan. We deal with a lot, we're Houston-based, so we deal with a lot of oil and gas clients, unsurprisingly, but we also nuclear, as well as moving very rapidly into the utility space, which seems to be a very good fit with the kind of products and services that we produce. So predominantly mobile applications that are focusing on business transformations. People come in with a business problem, and there's this gap between the business problem and then the software, and the way to bridge that is through a good analysis of what the actual problem is and how the user plays in that. So our methodology is really focusing on the appropriate amount of technology to enhance user performance trying to accomplish a task. So.
And so, Jared, you know, one of the fun things is, you know, you have this design element, and one thing I've always regretted about our industry is that, you know, the engineer that can speak the best becomes the CEO in a lot of these energy sort of experiences. But the design has often been historically the forgotten piece, which is the user-friendly or non-user-friendly experience.
Yeah, and I think that's really true. And I mean, design having a seat at the table is a common theme throughout the industry. They're often focused at sort of, you know, putting lipstick on a pig of a project, trying to get it out the door, and they're doing usability and saying, well, it doesn't work very well, but you know, it's got to ship, right? So.
Yeah.
The key thing that I think we do at Chaiwan is because we got an opportunity to sort of start our design process from scratch, we really analyzed, you know, Six Sigma and Lean and
agility
and design thinking and craft a methodology that would be appropriate for things like opening and closing an oil pipeline with one hand on your phone. Right, so you got to get that right. You can't pivot. You can't, you know, iterate and, you know, build another refinery. It was only $1 billion down the drain. Right, so we take a very scientific and very stringent approach to how we define and solve these problems, which is why things like shiny objects and new technology, we take a very measured approach to what is the appropriate technology and how you can bring that. So. We do have some Apple Watch applications out there, which are some of the first in industry in general. And they're a great way of like capturing data and displaying data. But you know, once again, they don't solve every problem, and they can potentially create a bunch of new problems. So we try to balance that when we're recommending any technology to our clients.
Well, the design doesn't matter if the technology doesn't work, and we have a chief technology officer of
Constreet, Bert, and who, I mean, honestly, you know, we followed your work for years, but, you know, for those that are coming in from out of state and other places, please share not only about the CTO role at Constreet, but a little bit about why it was formed, who it serves, so that it's not necessarily the same as VR and wearables and all that, but perhaps that's the next language for you guys to work in. You guys work in other advanced technologies and use cases. Please share a little bit about that. Is that cool?
So yeah, when we started Constreet, we had a very narrow goal of accumulating high-resolution residential energy data, which it really hasn't been done before, and to some extent, it still hasn't been done anywhere
else.
World's
first independent research-based meter network?
That's right, yeah. So totally independent. We work directly with customers behind the meters. We're really, we've become quite proficient at identifying early adopters, and that's been a huge benefit for us because...
Yeah, give us some samples of that. I mean, because you guys have seen these early techs and you guys have been like, hey, we'll be the shepherd, we'll help with some of this mess.
Right, yeah. It turns out if you identify the right communities of people, there are early adopters out there that are eager to try new things and to give you really valuable feedback on whether or not it works. And the problem is if you go out and try to get a statistically valid sample of a diverse demographic, most of those people, part of that diversity is they just don't care and they won't tell you what's going on. So we really focus on the early adopters. The good news is they want the same things as everybody else. They're just more verbal and proactive about finding it. So we start with that as our platform. And then we apply a lot of the things we've been hearing about, what the mayor said last night, rapid failure, rapid iteration.
Yeah.
That's critical. And so we have a somewhat vertically integrated as a 15-person company can be. we make our own sensor packages, our own IoT. We're building our own energy switch with some DOE funding to help overcome a lot of the roadblocks in solar adoption. And what we really focus on is finding things that are disruptive, finding things that destroy business models. And over time, what has happened now is companies are coming to us and asking us to help them develop their products, particularly at the early stages where they need to really test out a value proposition with early adopters.
You know, one thing I've, just as a point of order, and you said disruptive, but I've noticed at this conference, tell me if this is cultural, because y'all travel around a lot. In Texas, I hear people say the word emerging technology, and in Cali and DC and New York, I hear disruptive a lot.
Yeah.
What's up with that?
I don't know.
I don't know.
I hear it.
Cultural inflection.
Yeah, I noticed that too. I think it kind of depends on, I've noticed it depending on which industry people are coming from, but when you're on West Coast and you're in more of the tech bubble, if you will.
Ad click based revenue generation.
Yeah, that's what you hear.
Maybe disruptive sells better.
When you talk to people like Bert who actually deploy things and make stuff and get stuff done, you hear emerging technology. I don't know.
Well, but from a municipal standpoint, we don't want things to be disruptive.
That's what I'm saying.
We need it to be emerging. Disruptive is very bad. Lights go out when it's disruptive.
If you're trying to sell something to a utility, the Captain Obvious word to avoid is disrupt, right?
Yeah. That's not a positive term.
We stopped using blow-up things a lot.
Yeah.
So in the blast zone of this project, that's a good point.
Yeah.
So let me just go through a lightning round, and I want each of you to sort of name one or two sort of use cases that are on your mind for the future that don't have a technology around them yet. Or tell us about a new technology that you find really, just a myriad of opportunity that perhaps doesn't have that defined use case. For instance, microgrids. There's 10 or 12 different uses for that, and yet we just heard an earlier panel where it was like, really you can narrow that down to two, right? So, maybe start with Bert. You get to test and play, and you and Scott, play in a sandbox all day. So what's some of the, what are maybe main uses that you haven't really seen a technology for and some technologies you don't know the use for yet?
Well, the one that captures most of our attention right now is turning individual homes into a microgrid.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Real estate aligning with energy. Can you internalize the values for each other in sales and stuff like that?
Yeah, well, the if you look at the adoption curve for solar, it's already set and it's huge.
Yes.
And the install base is doubling in the U.S. and worldwide every 2 years. So the there are some obstacles that people are talking about, and we're addressing those obstacles directly. One is the disruption to the utility grid, mm-hmm. and so we're developing a technology that makes makes a residential microgrid more benign and, in fact, helpful to the grid. And then the second thing is general consumer confusion. They all want solar. They love the idea of batteries, but there's still a lot of confusion about what am I buying? What does it do? Is it gonna? Am I still gonna have power if the grid goes down? Mm-hmm. A lot of people are shocked to find that their solar panels don't work when their grid goes down. Right. So we've looked at all these requirements and we've put together a system that can handle every utility business model that's being discussed, plus yes. A few business models that are not being discussed right now. And we're developing that, demonstrating it, and promoting it so that the market can move to a place where comfortable, where the consumer is really comfortable making the purchase, and where the utility is really comfortable having that connected to their grid.
That's great. Now, sorry, customer confusion, were you saying that is a use case or sort
well,
of
it is. It represents, to us it's a use case because the use case is a customer buys a microgrid and installs it in their home. That's the use case. And then how do they use that? What are their objections to buying that? What are their motivations? Is it economic? Is it resiliency? Is it the cool factor? Obviously, the people that we work with early want to test it out.
Yeah.
But to be to really keep up with the this doubling of installation, it's got to get beyond the cool factor. It's got to become an invisible technology that makes everybody's life better.
Yes.
And where they don't really have to put out any effort.
Yeah.
So that's kind of what we're targeting.
Jared, you guys have some whiz bang stuff, but I think one of the most interesting things that I think you shared was that VR mm-hmm. technology. I mean, please sort of use that as a start off point, but share whatever else you want to share.
Sure. I mean, I think that there's a there's sort of the inward facing and the outward facing of the utility lens, right? So, the outward facing is the IoT world, which I personally think is a is an impending user interface catastrophe in the making because of the warring groups that are all trying to own different protocols and
yes.
who's going to have what, and ultimately the user ends up suffering as a result of that. So that's one thing that I see as a huge opportunity challenge, however you want to slice that. Now, if you're looking inward, where we spend a lot of our time on the B2B side of things, we have multiple blog posts around how AR and VR technology is incredibly dangerous. It doesn't actually work, and I think that has actually changed. We've saw some stuff in the last few months that has really turned the corner for my lead researcher and I around whether or not this is a viable platform. That this is something that can be useful. Some of the use cases we're seeing are. Around, so specifically, you have remote projection, so there's people that are donning a VR helmet and looking at something remotely that would be either challenging, dangerous, or whatnot to be able to look around a room that's contaminated, so we're doing radiation control, things like that. Every minute that people aren't exposed, you get a hard ROI back on reducing that time of exposure. As well as overlaying data like heat maps and other sensory data, so you've got SCADA arrays inside these plants, overlaying that in VR and going, okay, there's the problem. The ability to share that and collaborate in that space without physically being in that space, we think is huge. AR is a little bit lighter touch. It's a lot easier to sort of roll out. The Google Glass was, I guess, an experiment, like kind of a catastrophe. It was a lot of things that weren't really working well, but it was an interesting step in sort of stimulating that conversation. But the idea of remote access to data is really interesting. I think that the problem that a lot of people have had when trying to implement these things is that they're looking at, well, we do VR, and so here's VR. We do AR, we do AR. And then missing things like the gesture control. So things like the Mayo controller, which reads your synaptic data in your tendons.
Yes.
So you can just put a bracelet on and have full 3D control in a very non burdensome manner. We see that augmented with things like the Vocalix or natural language processing, so that you can be looking and you can be gesturing, but you can also be talking, and synthesizing this in sort of a unified user experience, where you're hitting all of these different layers that you would in the real world do with somebody you're working with, but bringing that all together into one sort of complete package. That's where we see sort of the opportunity over the next 12, 18 months.
Yeah.
In terms of doing some, you know.
Real quick, can you scale something like that across a whole lineman corps or like a whole, like, well, like say a utility like yours where you have what, you know, 5 major generation points? Mm-hmm. I mean, could they have at every one of those generation, like could they have all their staff on that kind of technology in the next 2-3 years?
Well, I mean, you're looking at probably a $2,000 to $5,000 price point for a contemporary consumer VR system right now.
Yes.
Now, then there's the LiDAR or right. However you're doing, there's a lot of different ways of mapping these spaces, whether you're inputting 3D data and simulating it, or you're actually doing real-time sort of 360 movies and applying that. I think the question is not if, but of course you can do that. I mean, this is possible. The technology, I think, has arrived. But the why is more important, right? So what problem are you solving, and how does that come back to ROI, right? So,
yeah.
I mean, you can have drones flying down your lines and checking all of this stuff out, but you know, that drone crashes and it has the same problems with storms that everybody else does, and then you've got a guy in the truck that you were trying to replace going out there to pick up the drone that crashed, you know, during the storm. So you got to kind of, these are complex systems, and we really think that strategic measurement and review before sort of running after that shiny object is really important, because otherwise you end up with some expensive failures that got off on the wrong foot, and then that kind of like sours the deal for any other innovation in those spaces.
Dude, it's happened before in our industry. We had something happen in Boulder, Colorado that sort of pushed us back a few years. So, Liz, you get to deal in a lot of use cases that are really relevant and useful, but one of the things I like about you is that your job is totally all-inclusive. It needs to serve the whole customer base. So industrial, commercial, residential. So don't just give us a residential thing, please, but give us some use cases that you're seeing and some technology that you're really interested in. And sort of how you sort of see marrying them for a service, maybe that isn't available in a year, but like this is a beachhead that I want to reach, you know, where this really empowering people with actionable information.
Right. So
we're already doing some of that.
Yeah. So we're already doing some of that. So one of the things that we're really focused on is pulling together all different types of data, so that internally we know exactly who our customers are, because they expect that. Our customers expect that when they contact us, regardless of who they are, we already know them. We know what they like, what they don't like, that they've already participated in a program. So we're trying to get to that point. We also want to get to the point where the customer has enough information about their usage so that they can make better decisions. So that when they made the choice to turn everything on Monday morning, and then they get that high bill at the end of the month, they realize that's been their choice. Because they've had enough education to say, "Oh, yeah, I shouldn't do that." Mm. But it's all about the education, and it's not necessarily a fun topic. Not everybody wants to learn about KW and KWH. But if you can turn that into dollars and have them understand that, you know, staggering your turn on is a different, can result in a different outcome. You know, one 15-minute block can impact your entire bill.
Yeah.
You know, a process can simply impact your ROI. So it's things like that. And so, you know, one of the things
and
for us.
And also has a history of a community that will proactively put on demand response just because they want to be clean and help the grid.
We have a big segment that's like that. We have a huge segment that will jump at the chance to do the green thing, the socially right thing,
keep Austin weird.
Exactly. But here's the really interesting thing we've learned recently, that people will do that up to a point.
Threshold.
That's right. And then when it becomes too difficult in their mind, and that could be a variety of reasons. It's not convenient, or it for whatever their threshold is, it becomes costly. They will stop, and then the conversation gets flipped. And especially in the world of renewables, the conversation flips to, well, I don't know why I have to pay for that because the sun is free and the wind is free. And so then we have to have an entirely different conversation around that. And so one of the use cases that we're constantly pushing is the idea of information and education. We can't get anybody to change anything that they're doing unless they have the
right
information.
It's very affordable too.
Yeah. Right, that's why, you know, we call, at least in a meeting this week, we were calling Shine Solar After Dark. because it was really simple. You know, you don't have to call it about batteries or storage. It's solar after dark. People
I
get
like
that.
I like that. I actually like that. You should trademark that quick. Someone here.
Bobby.
Bobby, on it.
Thank you.
Trademark.
But, you know, I mean, it really is all about education because, like I said earlier, it's not top of mind, yeah. But it can empower people to make a difference. So yeah. That's what we try and do.
You guys go from idea to implementation insanely fast. How? Why? And I know it's a different question from everyone else, and I'll give you the use case question next, but how do you guys do that so fast? What's the secret behind the sauce?
I like to think of my job as... so
working 80 hours a week?
Sometimes, but I truly, I have a lot of people that work for me and with me that are very talented. So I have to give them a lot of the credit, but I like to think of my role in the organization and my team's role is, you know, when we're talking about these far out use cases, we're talking about the early adopters like the pecan streeters and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. So we're really...
So you're thinking about specifically, oh, can we test and validate in that kind of space?
We do, and we work with Bert's team quite a lot,
cool.
Actually.
Awesome.
So
nice
that's,
there you go.
Yeah, they're really great if you're...
I knew that, so that's great. So
yeah.
We're just
so, but as I was saying, you know, a lot of these use cases are so far left on the innovation curve, if you will. Like, they're so early adopter. I like to think of what my job is to try to bring people up the curve. So
yeah.
Bring it to more people, reduce friction in the customer experience, make things simple, engage them where they want to be
so
engaged.
Simplifying the education.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
yep.
And another thing I remember, you know, at AE, something that AE did really well is that testimonial of the person that's mm-hmm. done it that looks like you, talks
mm-hmm.
like you, experiences things like you.
Right.
Blood
right.
doesn't boil about capacity issues or anything like that. Mm-hmm. It just makes sense and is simplified.
Right.
Part of the way that we do things quickly is it's not being afraid to fail. And we have failed. Several things we put in the market have failed. But
early
a lot
iterations
of
failure.
Yeah, and a lot of things we've done have been very successful. So
do
it's
you mind
just,
telling us about a fail-forward moment?
Yeah. So we've had several thermostat partnerships that we've
yeah.
worked with. And you know, if we were designing things for a nuclear reactor or something like that, we would have to the nth level of control and security around it. But you know, when we're doing something that is with consumer technology, consumers are a little more forgiving, and we have to iterate on the prototype to be able to get it out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we learned early on. We did. I won't name names, but we did a partnership with a thermostat company, not Nest, and we brought together some integrations of a couple different technologies. And put that in market with customers, several thousand customers in Texas, and we found that the experience was too complicated. We weren't able to abstract away enough of the complexity behind the scenes to make it work. And you know, that's a lot of what we're doing in the energy disaggregation work that we're doing,
yep.
And the anomaly detection work that we're doing.
The direct your energy bill.
The direct your energy.
The disaggregated version.
Right, right.
And that's a big step for the industry.
Yeah.
Does everyone know about disaggregation of your bill and sort of?
If you don't,
nodding our heads, I like it.
If you
have a smart audience, I think they get it.
Yeah, and there's also a giant orange.
I was just going to say
truck in the front.
The
if you want to look at
inspiration,
it.
Demo trailer is also
that's
available
right.
for happy hour later. So
that's
you can
right. So
get the full tour yourself.
Yeah. So and we actually Jared's group actually helped us do the mobile version of that web app that we launched, and then I see Noah in the back from Grid4C, and they did a lot of the data science work that really is the engine that makes it successful. And so it's about, to us, when we put that into market, it's very simple messaging to customers, but it's very powerful because
but synchronized, that's not yeah. easy across organizations.
No, and so we have to synchronize with utility meter data. We have to do the analytics behind the scenes. We have
the
to
story.
Understand what the insights are, and then crafting that story for the customer and giving them what's their next best action,
yeah.
what is helpful to them, thinking
yeah.
from their perspective. Is just a first start, but when you talk about use cases and where we want to go, we want to continue down that path of making things simple for customers, reducing friction for them so that they are delighted by the experience.
Mm-hmm.
And we will experiment with different ways to make money on that, but we have an advantage of just being in a market where people are used to paying you already. So I'm not a Spotify, I don't have to get my credit card out and pay you. I already pay you every month for my energy bill. And likewise, I'm used to paying a bill to fix my HVAC system, fix my water heater, stuff like that. So the use case that I'm really excited about and I'm really excited that we're going to be working on is you know, how do we get the right level of technology in the home, and or maybe just meter data at a starting level, and understanding what things might be breaking or what things might be happening in your home that we can then action behind and make very seamless for the customer.
Is this like a personal resilience score? Like instead of like you getting a grid score, it's like saying how like reliable you are, like, you know, like, you're not really reliable, your computer is jacked, you know?
Yeah, actually, that may be an interesting way of thinking about it. I think what we, I think it's very simple, though. It's just, we know, when I talk about, you know, abstracting away the very complex things that, you know, our teams do, we can see from the data if your HVAC system is malfunctioning.
Huge.
If
balance can be a huge cost.
And if you're going to get home and your air conditioner is not going to be working.
Right.
And we're trying to work on ways to make that tech more advanced so that you're just you know, on the road in Austin and you get an alert and you know, it seems like I need maintenance, I can schedule it and that it happens.
Yeah.
And maybe you have a door lock to let the technician in when they get there as well.
That's cool. I've heard about the geolocated GE one where it's like literally within 5 miles of your house, it triggers and it starts working by the time you get in. And it just follows your phone rather than you. And that brought me to a thought, and I apologize, but you're starting to talk about nodes and sensors and everything. And actually, for what it's worth, guys, I want to break it up so that you guys can ask some questions. I see some folks that I know that are in the space that do some pretty cool things, so feel free to ask questions. But I just have, actually, Jared, a quick question. So talking about, and actually for anyone, but sensors and nodes, Thierry Goddard, I don't know if you heard him yesterday, but he brought up one really badass idea, which was basically, and this is an indirect causal sort of insurance thing, but knee pads with sensors in them to count how many times you're on your knees before you got back pain, because at that point your premium goes up and it's really expensive for them to keep you employed. Wow, I mean, like, dude, it has zero to do with ancillary systems, asset management. It's the human, and it's driving the success. If that back goes out, he's there, and something happens just a line down, what happens next, right? Yeah. So these are like indirect causal relationships, but
I can give you an example
Please.
Of that.
And if all of you have something like that, I'd love to hear, because those have zero to do with energy, but it serves everything about energy.
Well, it's at Direct Energy and Centrica, you know, we have a focus on safety. Obviously, we own generation assets in the UK and used to own some here. And
sold a lot of them. All of them are gone in the US, right?
Correct.
So you have a lot of money you're sitting on.
That,
sweet.
Oh, I don't know why I'm here. no, but so where was I going with that? And we also have thousands of engineers and technicians in the field every day working in customers' homes. And so we've been looking at this kind of data for quite a long time. And even very simply, take a use case of reverse parking in a parking space.
Okay.
It's much, much more safe and reduces accidents and injuries to park in reverse when you park in your parking spot, because most injuries in a parking lot happen when you're backing out of your space. So we are able to use GPS information from and car information from the actual vehicles to understand when people are reversing in before they park. And that helps us, you know, cultivate a culture of safety in the organization.
Which increases morale because they feel like you care for them as much as they care about their job.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Any sensor node stories, or Jared, or anyone?
Well, the flip side of that, which is part goes back to the education and awareness, is when you're putting GPS in people's cars, because you are concerned about their safety, you have to make sure that you put that information out there of why you're doing it, so they don't think that you're big brother and trying to monitor where they're going.
Totally. Yeah.
So there is that. There is that type of information.
And we have and that even one
step,
too.
Even one step further than that is any information that you are capturing, you're potentially liable for. So if somebody's wearing, if you're tracking somebody's heartbeat and they have a heart attack, and that was you were aware of that, what is your legal responsibility? So we had some of our clients say, we want to know this, but not any further of that. Dealing with some of the security operations that we're dealing with, we have encrypted beacons that change the UI based on where you are in the process, but we can't show where the security officers are. That information could not exist anywhere. So you can't, you know, as an evildoer, get a map and see where all of the guys are running around, running the rounds. So we have to abstract and generalize that they are, you know, at this checkpoint, but not, you know, standing over there. Things also around identifying people and things of that nature is another constraint. We see some real easy use cases around like ear protection, so tracking decibels with wearables, vibrating, you know, telling you to put in your ear protection if it goes over a certain point. Humans are oddly not a very good judge of some of their own environmental constraints. Things around temperature and all of those kind of things, other exposures that you can start to synthesize and put that, you know, put that information to work at keeping that human safe.
New tech is super expensive though, so this is enough of a value that the price point is a cost.
Most of our clients fear, I think, nothing more than a lawsuit.
Yeah.
Right. Oh, yeah, so exactly. I mean, that's you know, somebody falls, and you know, knowing that in advance, there's a lot of. We did some interesting generative research last summer for a major mobile handset maker. Around aging population, right? Mm-hmm. And so how do you design, you know, and a lot of our work is around these extreme use cases from tundra to desert to, you know, reactors and whatnot, but it actually is a good set of tools when you're looking at people in the home. And so as IoT rolls out, as these kind of things become more important, how are you designing that? Are you designing a way to make your grandmother a prisoner in her house with cameras tracking all the time, and she does anything wrong, then you know the fire department's out there? That's not what the users want, right? And so you have to strike that balance between I think one of the takeaways from the research was you don't want to design
the decision making.
Well, you don't want to design things that make people feel old. You want to design things that make people feel young, right?
Correct.
So that empowers them, that gives them the ability to do more as they age or have, you know, disability or things of that nature. You're empowering them, you're not constraining them and entrapping them. And I think that's an
easy... That's why I don't like autonomous vehicles, by the way. I have a friend that works for Google doing all the autonomous stuff. I'm like, if I want to go 80 because I'm late, I want to do that, your car better not stop me.
Yeah.
So like,
yeah.
I don't like that whole notion.
Yeah, it's an interesting... The idea of... control and whether or not, you know, that's a good idea or not is something I'll leave to the policymakers.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I drive 80 a few times myself. But but you know, it's an interesting thing. Like where does users have control? I mean, if the insurance companies are in charge of everything, we'll be going 55 in autonomous vehicles, and that will be kind of, you know, Wall-E like, I guess, is where our future
so
trends,
true.
Right? So what do we? I think that we as leaders, especially as you enter into people's homes or on their body, you need to be very suspicious of your own motivations and your own plans to implement and control things. I mean, we have some rules around contextual design that we're formulating. And I mean, my father can change a light bulb, no problem. Can he change a smart light bulb? Absolutely not. Right? Mm-hmm. So that isn't smarter. That's added complexity, that's added failure into the system with something that's been working fine for, you know, 100 years. Mm-hmm. So how are we improving things? And I think that, you know, we have one of our conceptual measures that we roll out is called the elevator test, right? So if you live in a 30-story building, elevators are fantastic, right? I mean, you're not gonna carry groceries up 30 flights of stairs without an elevator. But when that stops working, you need to have that stairway there. And that is a fundamental, like designing for failure, designing for degrees of failure is really important. So what happens when the internet goes off? My boss got locked out of his house with the Bluetooth locks because the internet provider cut the line. That's not the IoT future. I mean, with another 30 billion devices, and it was August in Houston with his like newborn and stuff. It wasn't comical. And so when we start dealing with things like light, and temperature, and access, and security, and all of these things, and you start plugging more and more things in, how is this going to be an actual improvement? It needs to be as good as an elevator, right? Like, zoom, there you go up, but there's a way to get down, right? I mean, a backup.
Bert, I mean, sorry, I just gotta ask, you know, I remember early on in Pecan Street, some technology solution providers trying some really interesting stuff of use cases that didn't end up panning out, right? It was an early iteration, right? And they were big folks trying something big. And what was interesting was, to your point, it felt like sometimes these companies were fetishizing the technology rather than the person using it. And like, you become a slave to this technology, kind of. Like, it's sort of like your Bluetooth lock. Can you tell us what to avoid in that? I mean, I know you and Brewster have seen a lot of this. What are some of the, like, rules of the road for you guys as far as when you hear a new pitch and you hear a new technology idea, What are some like fundamental things? Well, if you can't answer these first three things, yeah, you got to find it.
Well, the example just mentioned is a great one. I mean, that we would never.
Which one?
The there's lock one. Example.
Yeah.
I mean, that's something we might try it at my house or Grant's house.
You guys really will.
Yeah, yeah. But we would never deploy.
You guys installed it all in your own homes before you asked your clients to do it.
Absolutely. And we would never deploy something on a large scale that could break and leave somebody in that situation. It doesn't take a whole lot of foresight to figure that out. And so that's key. But the other thing I was reminded of in hearing this, one of the technical problems we're really focused on now is auto discovery. And so if you want to buy half a dozen moisture sensors to put around your house to stop tens of thousands of dollars worth of water damage, right now, most people that want to do that probably just can't, they're not up to the technical task. You have to type in, you have to download, go to a website, you have to type in some codes, they're long codes.
A login and a password too, probably.
An elderly person is not going to be able to accurately put in the 12-digit registration number for each device. What if you just scan the barcode on the package with your phone and then just stick them all over and everything else auto-discovers, it talks to your phone, it finds your base station in your house, your phone is already authorized to contact the base station, therefore the sensors can go to the base station. That kind of out-of-the-box experience is what you have to have.
It reminds me of Adobe Reader. Adobe Reader, you used to need to install it, and now it's in every computer, right? And so you don't. There's four or five steps I don't need to do anymore when I buy a new computer. What are those things for the next home?
Maintenance on these devices is huge. Yeah. So I have, it's an OBD2 connector for my car that tracks where I go and how much mileage and how much that ride costs and all that stuff for expensing things when I drive to Houston and whatnot. Yeah. And it automatically updates and upgrades the firmware passively whenever I'm in the car with my phone and not driving. I don't have to touch anything. There's
nice.
Nothing to hit. I think the theme is the move from explicit interface to implicit interface, mm-hmm. right? So you're moving from complex user control to dissolved into your environment. I don't think that we'll probably have phones in about 5 years, so I think that the idea of the application.
You think the near field communication stuff of watches are just like a when, not if?
I think it's going to fracture.
Disney band.
I'll take the over.
Yeah.
I'll take the over? Nice.
Yeah.
I like it. Raise your hand if you think phones will be relevant in 5 to 10 years. 5 years.
Irrelevant or relevant?
Relevant.
Yeah. Irrelevant?
Okay. Who thinks they're not going to be relevant? I like it. All right.
Look forward.
Yeah. Okay,
the debate continues.
Okay, to represent the vast majority that are not technology savvy.
Okay.
And that are that are our grandparents or our parents
or me.
Or cool. Or low income, you know, that either don't have the expertise, don't have the income, you know, aren't gonna do that.
True, I mean, accessibility.
You think about the group of people that are just now coming into the smartphone world,
yes.
Because there are now plans that allow you to have a smartphone without having an elaborate plan.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Some of these, the technology that you guys are talking about, we got to make sure that we can use it without it being Wi-Fi enabled. You know, that there's some benefit that can happen for that customer without them being required to be connected to the internet or having Wi-Fi in their home and things. I know Google Fiber is coming into Austin. I know it's coming into a lot of different places, but it's still not accessible to everybody because it comes with a cost.
So true.
And I think that with the internet, you're looking at, you know, one single point of failure. If the internet, the overall internet mm-hmm. goes down, then not everything stops working is fundamentally flawed. I mean, you're seeing with blockchain and peer-to-peer kind of networks. I mean, this is already happening in China.
Do you mind sharing blockchain?
Blockchain is the fundamental encryption technology behind Bitcoin. It allows absolutely.
But it's not a currency related.
It's not a currency. It's a it's an encryption, a peer-to-peer encryption technology that allows you and me to safely exchange something without anyone else getting involved. Yep. And that's
all the bigs are getting involved in it now. IBM, yeah. GE, all these.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, with just, you know, from my context in China, I mean, the peer-to-peer payment of cash, like cash is just dissolving out of a culture that has mattresses stuffed with cash going back 5,000
right.
years, right?
Yeah, totally.
So the idea of just, you know, we see that with the Cash App now, that's kind of trickling in here, but your network, your home, should be your network. And yeah. you should have a certain, as the user, I bring a light bulb into my home, it should know that I'm there, it should it say I'm available, it should, you screw it in and it should be on, and I say light bulb on and the light bulb goes on, and that is the extent of it. That's a smart kind of implementation. There was a great article in Fast Company a year or so ago about a guy that was spent 4 hours updating the firmware on his light bulbs. Right? I mean, this is just non-viable, right? So we need to get ahead of all of this stuff and really look at the users. You know, when we're doing these designs for elderly and for extreme conditions, you're pushed into, okay, connectivity issue. I can tell you in the desert, out in the snow fields, out in a nuclear reactor, which is designed to keep electromagnetic radiation and any other kind of radiation out, you have to design for these kind of failures. And so really taking that user-centered point of view and saying the user, the home, the neighborhood, the city, yeah. and building out from there, as opposed to here's a product and we're going to kind of mm-hmm. stick it there and we hope that that works with your other things that are happening. I mean, that's yeah. that is not the way Silicon Valley yeah. is designing things right now.
And it's such a true point because it's all 25-year-old white men. So it's interesting. So my first job in college was working with quadriplegics who can't use their arms and legs. They literally had extended either straws that they put the old rubber erasers on, or they had pencils and they did the same thing. And they would do it either with their mouth or with a device so that they could slowly click on a keyboard.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Seems unfair. And when I left that job, I worked with preschool kids in mm-hmm. the neighborhood, and it was a different accessibility point. But I mean, what you bring, Liz, is so real, because it's like the left behind, dude. You know, we see Trumpism rising, and I think part of it is because a great deal of society is feeling existentially and technically left behind. There's mm-hmm. They feel like their story has not been told. And so I think that's just a pull up on all of our joy and exuberance around new technology is that I think, and I will say each one of you brought up prudence at some mm-hmm. point. I'm sorry to say something.
No, I'm just agreeing with what you're saying. I think that there's a lot of fear, uncertainty, and doubt in people's minds when they think about this space. And it goes back to really, how do you build things that with intentionality around how transparent that's supposed mm-hmm. to be? Mm-hmm. And blockchain is sort of the most transparent. Yeah.
And it's end-to-end safe, which is a really exciting element about it.
Well, yeah, I could go on all day about blockchain. It's very interesting to me. But one use case for blockchain about transparency of information is tracing sources of energy. So mm-hmm. using blockchain as Jared was describing, is basically an open source distributed ledger, so that it's you know, unhackable, if you will, if you have enough nodes in the distribution of the network. And right. so when you have this immutable ledger, you can trace diamonds from Africa, you can trace sources of coal and fossil fuels from the places where they're generated to the places where they're consumed. And I think that's pretty cool, because
that is really cool.
That gives people a real sense.
That's governance and accounting of every electron.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So I think that's really neat. But then we think about the elderly as well, because we think about home care. And you know, when we think about the connected home, how can we serve that market? So you have to Jared's point, really design with those in mind. People don't want a life alert necklace that they have to wear.
They don't
right?
push the button. That's the thing that's interesting is like the users, they have this little button.
They're
that,
embarrassed.
You know, call 911 if you fall down. But they'd rather lie on the floor than have the EMS come to their house
Absolutely.
And everybody kind of laugh at them as the old person.
Totally. So what we think about is more how can we get that information in a way that makes the elderly person happy, and then also me as the caretaker happy.
Yeah.
Because it turns out we can tell just by how you consume your energy, how active you're being in your home, your presence, are you using hot water, things of that
There's
nature.
There's a level of emotional intelligence in some of this.
Yeah,
it's
I mean, it's when you really start digging under the covers of the data that we have and things that we can know if we want to know them, it's kind of scary and then also exciting at the same time, because we can do something, we can provide you that peace of mind that, you know, your elderly grandmother, you know, took a shower this morning, and that
dude,
means something to people.
Dude, totally, actually. Yeah. I've asked way too many questions. Guys, there's so much to work with here. Does anyone have any questions before we get into sort of closing comments from the speakers? Yeah, George, please. Oh, good example. Please tell them, George, tell them what you do and all that stuff. And
George, the founder of Remains. The question is, we are all speaking about new technologies. What is, let's say, let's imagine that you wake up in the morning, a mobile app that you are dreaming the time that you will come to your services. So a mobile app in the energy sector, an application in the energy sector that you are dreaming of, and you want this to happen.
We're building it.
Next person?
Who are you building it with?
That's a good question.
What generally, ephemerally kind of problem does it solve?
No, well, I'll go first. For us, because Direct Energy and Centrica, because of our business unit, I mean, I started out by saying we don't want to be everything to everyone because that space is confusing and crowded. We want to provide meaningful solutions to people that allow us to use our other services more effectively. So, an app that can detect when things are misperforming or malfunctioning in your home, that can schedule a technician to come and fix it for you, that can give you insights about what things in your home you should be insuring versus what should you not be insuring. Why have life insurance when you're 19 years old, kind of a type of a mentality, versus I have a 15-year-old AC unit and I'm now seeing the readings that this maybe I should start saving to buy a new one, or maybe I should put a protection plan on that so that I have more peace of mind that my home is in good shape and I don't get surprised. So,
Bert,
simple.
Mobile applications, you guys have been involved in a few. What are some of the ones that you see on your radar?
We're doing all kinds of stuff. I'd say the best app is no app at all. I want to use all the energy when I want it for whatever I want. I want to focus on creating things using tools, using appliances. I don't want to worry about energy. I want that to just be there when I need it. So I think that's where we all want to get, but these apps are a transitional period while we change over to a era of energy abundance.
Interesting. And what answer are you on the relevance of phones in 5 to 10 years?
We'll have something called a phone. I don't know what it's going to look like.
Okay.
I was a little touched.
I think that's sort of what you meant, Jared.
I'm not saying that we won't have technology, just to be clear. I'm saying that I think I have a 3.5-year-old and a 7-month-old, and I don't think that they will have something called a phone. Okay. I don't think that that will be an object that persists. They're shrinking away. I mean, this, in the last 2 weeks even. Yeah, exactly. Exactly right. Yeah, and just to the question of what do I sort of dream of? I mean, maybe it's just Austin traffic that's kind of gotten me lately. But the idea of with the energy abundance, I was kind of headed that direction with my answer, and I had to pivot. But the idea of logistics independence, so the idea of an automated school bus for my kids, and how do you get around, and the idea of taking anything that's eliminating a drudgery from human existence is kind of generally a positive. So for me, my wife just learned to drive about a year ago. So how will that change our lifestyle, having the rest of our family with that kind of independence and location independence in general, which I think that the world of energy and all of that are enabling is pretty pretty mind blowing.
Yeah.
So
any last comments that can be under 15 seconds each? Maybe sort of a last thought on the most important thing you've learned in developing new technology? Just a small question. 15 seconds or less.
Research and eliminate all of the assumptions from your process.
Ooh, nice. I like it.
Saying the same thing. Test out your idea with a lot of other people. Make sure you're not out in the weeds somewhere. Mm.
Customers are more than just residential and commercial. They can go into as many buckets as you could probably design.
Customers aren't necessarily ratepayers.
They are not ratepayers. Yeah. They are customers. Yeah. They are customers. And even in our monopoly, they might not be able to go someplace, but if we don't treat them as a customer that we value, they will cause us more problems than we will ever be able to solve.
That's one of the biggest blind spots we have. When you go in the car lot, that car salesman does not see you as a rate cutter. Mm-hmm. Not in the grocery store, not in any other model except a monopoly regulated utility.
Yep.
It's such an important point.
Yeah, but I will tell you, I've been with the utility for 11 years, and when I started there, it was ratepayers and end users, and now we now use the word customer, and there are some groups that have the penalty jar where I tell them they need to put $25 in a quarter isn't going to do anything, but you know when they start using ratepayer, because it really is all about the customer, and you've got to value them as that person who's using your commodity.
Garrett,
I agree with everything that they said. I guess if I had to add something, it would be. While we are testing and piloting and working on new technology, you know, we have to relentlessly remove friction in the customer experience. Mm-hmm. In places, it goes from when you make hardware, you know, you've got to start with the installation process, and we've all been talking about that. Installing light bulbs, hubs, it's impossible in a lot of cases, and it's caused several companies to go under. So making that, removing the friction for customers installing things, using things, and then, you know, being delighted by the experience. So,
guys, thank you for being so smart and making this easy for me. I really appreciate it. Well, this has been awesome. Guys, thank you so much for coming. We appreciate the time. Thank you. You can feel free to stop them from going to their next panel by asking them a question.